I am Issa Shivji, formerly of the University of Dar es Salaam, and now director of Yara Resource Center, which is organized under the Tanzanian Commission for Science and Technology. Today I have great pleasure to present to you Professor Michael Bier from Germany. He has come to our country to participate in the activity of Yara Resource taking place on Friday, June 17th. So I thought it is important for us to take the opportunity to have a conversation with Professor Michael Bier, and we are going to have a conversation on the future of socialism. At this time, in our country and on the continent, and perhaps even in the world, there is no better time than to talk again about socialism. And in a moment we will know why it is so important. So before we go into the topic, Professor, let me start by asking you if you could briefly give us your background.
Yes. Hello. I am coming from Eastern Germany, the former German Democratic Republic. I was teaching philosophy at the Humboldt University, and after unification I worked for several German scientific organizations, and since 1999 I was a founding member of the Rosa Luxemburg Foundation, which is a socialist foundation close to the left party of Germany.
Good. Professor, in our conversations you mentioned certain things very interesting, and particularly similar to somewhat similar to the African experience. And I would like to tell us a few things about when the unification of the two Germanies took place. What was that experience? How was that process?
Yes, it's a very interesting experience. On the one hand, we had seen the decline of the Soviet Union and the Eastern countries, of socialist countries, and large popular movements in Poland, Hungary, but also in Eastern Germany to take over power in these countries. In 89 we had tremendous demonstrations in large cities of GDR at this time, and this ended in free elections in 1990 in March, and a new government was elected. So it was really a movement of liberating ourselves from a dictatorship of a one-party state, and also overcoming the stagnation of this type of state, Soviet party socialism. What was interesting is that choosing the way of unification was a very special one. It was, in fact, it was not unification. We, as East Germany, joined the Federal Republic. It was not the unification on equals. We just decided to join the Federal Republic of Germany on the conditions of the Federal Republic of Germany.
Right.
The idea was to get by this unification, or with this entry into the Federal Republic, a very quick start for a new development. The problem was that this meant that we gave up all our ability to make our own decisions. It started with currency unification. We joined at this time German Deutsche Mark, the currency of Western Germany, and in one night the whole industry of Eastern Germany vanished because all the prices went up by three times. The second situation was that it was taken over by West German elites. If you are now today look on almost all ruling decision makers in Eastern Germany, in the field of economics, in the field of culture, but also partially in the field of politics, they are almost all coming from Western Germany, the same in the university area. And this led to a situation where we had, on the one hand, liberation from one type of dictatorship, on the other hand, we were somehow also, by our own decision, by our own democratic decision, colonized. And there was a redistribution of property, of land. 90% of the productive assets in Eastern Germany are belonging to West Germans, especially to the larger corporations, but also to the richer people in Western Germany. All this was financed especially by the wage earners of Western Germany. So it was only possible and moderated by a huge redistribution, of course, of money, but not from the top of Germany or Western Germany, but from the lower classes, from the working classes.
That's very interesting, because you are talking about this double movement, yeah, in a sense. On the one hand, liberation from a kind of very authoritarian, yeah, rule, and on the other hand, you actually find yourself in the arms of a colonial power, a kind of colonial power,
yeah,
which devastates and destroys the colonized people. Mm. Because I understand that even the skilled manpower, in the professional manpower, you know, they were overnight just out of job.
Now they left about 2 million. That means I would say about at least a fifth of the labor power of Eastern Germany. That means mostly high qualified engineers and so, yes, on, left to Western Germany, yeah, on their own. So they were there employed, but that again left Eastern Germany without its own capacity to develop. So after 25 years, after unification, yeah, 25 years, a quarter of a century, and after spending about at least 2 billion euro for financing this, 2 billion euro, mm, yeah, we still are lacking about one third of the productive capacity of West Germany, and this will go on for the next decades. So this is how history goes, the ambivalence and dialectics of,
yes,
history.
Yes, mm-hmm, yes. This is what we found, yeah, in Africa, you know. We fought for independence,
yeah,
we fought for liberation, and then we found ourselves in a post-colonial situation which raises newer problems of domination.
Yeah, different one, but
different ones, but
new
still
one. Yeah.
And that is why, you know, in I think it was in Congo, mm-hmm, Zaire, which, mm-hmm, used to,
yeah,
be called Zaire,
yeah,
you know, the people coined this new phrase that we have to fight now for second independence.
Yes, all over Germany or Europe, we should fight for a second wave of emancipation, or maybe the third wave, let's see.
Yes.
But it's important, it starts because, again, because capitalist system has enforced on all of us in Europe, in the United States, but of course on much worse and much lower conditions all over the world, this new type of domination and exploitation.
Mm.
That's why I think socialism is so important now again.
That's what I would like to
later.
Come. You talked about third wave. Mm. Maybe you could say waves of a large landscape of history.
Yeah.
Okay, these three waves of development and how you see it is dialectic.
I think often if we are speaking about socialism in the European context, we are looking only back to the Soviet Union. Yeah? Mm. We are identifying socialism with the Soviet Union. Maybe you in Africa or Tanzania are identifying it with Nyerere.
Yes.
But we should understand firstly, socialism emerged in the end of the 18th century with the Great French Revolution, the ideas of freedom, liberty and brotherhood or solidarity. Mm. And we have all over the 19th century, it was like a childhood of socialism. A lot of experiments, a lot of ideas, a lot of attempts like the Paris Commune,
yes,
or Robert Owen, who organized first cooperatives and so on. It was really a very lively movement, and it influenced the movements for already at this time in Haiti against slavery. It influenced the women's movement in China, the Taipei, the peasants movement, and so on all over, but as formed different forms of experiments. Then we had the second wave starting in the 20th century with, of course, the October Revolution, with the strong social democratic governments organizing a kind of cage for capitalism, yeah, regulating under democratic and social control, building up strong social. And we had in the second wave, very important and too often forgotten, especially in Europe and not to speak about the United States, African socialism, Asian socialism, Latin American socialism, that means trying to avoid development into the trap of capitalism by using, and I think this was the idea of Nyerere very strongly, using the possibilities of traditional African community-based societies and using them and combining them with the achievements of modernity.
Right.
Yeah, and out of this, trying to create a new type of civilization. All these three currents, Soviet Union, social democratic regulation, and also third world socialism, somehow came to an end. One should discuss the different reasons, but we were not able on equals to compete with capitalism. One should be clear about this. But now we see, this is a third wave. Now I think capitalism somehow has fulfilled his role, creating the possibilities for different societies, material at least, productive capacities. And now I think we see a very deep civilizational crisis and all with relation to nature, at the global scale, the financial system, the democratic system is under pressure,
yes.
And so on. So we have a multi-fold civilizational crisis of our capitalist civilization. And this is the hour, I think, where we can see the emergence of new elements, new for a third wave of socialism. I'm totally convinced.
This is interesting because we witness, together with the development of capitalism, particularly the Industrial Revolution, you have these new ideas of alternative organization, whether it was Robert Owen cooperatives, culminating in major events like Paris Commune, or people forget that culminating in a very big revolution in what we call Haiti today. And there's a fantastic book by Sela James, the Black Jacobins. And then we enter into what we understand as socialism with the Soviet Union, Russian Revolution of 1917. And actually that period is quite short in historical terms. And yet that's the period which propagandists of capitalism often talk about when they talk about socialism. They forget that in fact socialism has been a search of humanity for an alternative to the evils of capitalism. And of course there was a time when we were told that socialism is dead. I remember Yerere, you know, when you talk about socialism, he says that, you know, you need to be a fool to talk about socialism these days. You see? But he believed. Even it was, he said that one day you'll come back to Arusha Declaration. You'll come back to socialism.
I agree.
And we're already witnessing it. We're already witnessing it. But Professor, obviously we cannot go back. But how do we learn from this experience of society to create this new society that all that humanity has been searched for?
Firstly, we cannot go back because the attempts, I think, of the second wave of socialism, at least if I'm looking on the Soviet experiences, were marked by a very, on the one hand, also in the social democracy in Western Europe, we tried to set free emancipatory movements, but in a way, at the same time, suppressing them. Also, as you said, creating authoritarian structures. And I think this is a lesson we should learn. You can never build up a mandatory society with these means. This is, I think, the most important lesson of the past. These means were dictated by a situation where the socialist forces were quite weak. Even the Soviet Union, Russia, was quite weak. And so we must overcome this type of weakness. How we can do it? I'm speaking from a European European perspective. I think African and Asians and Latin Americans should speak for themselves, and we should learn by this quite a lot. You see, we have a situation where the majority of the population in Germany and all over Western Europe, at least, is living in abundance. But how we are using this material abundance? You see, for the first time in world history, there are more people overweight than hungry. One should be aware of this. Yeah?
Yes.
So, but how we are using this abundance in this situation? We try to work even more, harder, to compete even more, to produce more, to spend more. All the questions how we can increase growth. Mm. But by increasing, at least under our conditions, growth, we on the one hand create other countries to compete and to sell their natural resources, to sell their labor power under very unequal terms. So we are making it for Africa, larger parts of Asia, or Latin America, very difficult, even more difficult than before, mm-hmm. And not improving our own situation. So it's a situation where all sides are losing. So right. How we can overcome this? I think we should. What is the most important thing at this moment? I think firstly we should recover the importance of what we are calling in our context the commons, the common goods, the community. What we are lacking, I think, is especially community building. And this is what I've learned by Nyerere. Yeah? Of course, he was referring to the African communities. But we have our own community experiences in the last, let's say, at least 2,000 or 3,000 years. Yeah? Very strong traditions. We have lost. Yeah? And we see now in Germany with the refugee problem. I think this is known to almost everybody. On the one hand, we see a lot of people who still have a community feeling. They try to help refugees. Yes. They try to go help them to the bureaucracy. They are giving them support. They are teaching them the German language. So this is very strong, and it's strong in those parts of our society where people are more or less integrated in some communities. Mm-hmm. And then we see others who are totally angry, fighting these refugees, setting their houses on fire. So what I think, what is maybe very strange, we are lacking strong, socially, culturally integrated communities where we find the sense of our life. And if you do not have a sense for yourself in the being for others, you will be against others. And this is the situation. You will be in competition, you will be in fight and struggle and so on. So I think this is all over. So starting from this, we should think how we can change our society in very different fields. Education, transport system, our enterprises, that they are much more like solidarity communities. I think this is the task, and only if we are able to solve this task in the 21st century, civilization can survive.
Yeah, I think you're making an interesting point. But the point is that how do you overcome the kind of individualism?
Yeah.
And this is not even the enlightened individualism of the 19th century. This individualism is actually narcissistic, you know, of neoliberalism.
Mm.
It is crass. And yet, that is the individualism which is ruling us. And you rightly point out that in both North and the South, the large majority of the people are suffering.
Mm-hmm.
Actually,
in different forms, suffering, but suffering. I'm totally sure.
Mm-hmm. So, in a sense, we have a common enemy, if that's how I would put it.
Mm-hmm.
Now, and yet, I think the ruling powers have been so successful in keeping the people divided by creating all kind of bogies. Now, for example, in Europe, the whole question of migrants. You know. So, basically pitching people against people. What we used to call at one time, during the Second World War, internationalism. When, for example, people showed the solidarity with Vietnam, they showed the solidarity with Mozambique, South Africa. I mean, there's a mass movement of solidarity. You must recognize that when you look back.
It was a mass movement of solidarity.
Yeah. I mean, people actually going to fight in other countries.
Mm-hmm.
You know? I mean, that was the finest moment, in a sense, of humanity. Okay. But we do not see that. Do you see that some seeds of that?
You see, firstly, I do not know if in Tanzania is known this movie with the different parts, Hunger Games. Hunger Games, you know it, yes? Hunger Games is... capitalism is creating a situation where everybody has to fight the other to survive. It starts already in the school. If you should compete with the others to get access, let's say, to the university.
Yeah.
Then you should fight the others to get access to the labor market. And then you should fight the others to get higher, to make career, and so on. And this means somehow, maybe not killing, but reducing the life possibilities of the others to survive.
Right.
And this we should overcome, because this is a deadly game. This is a deadly game, and this is organized between, you see, different regions in Africa are competing with Asia to attract investors. The same is in Europe. Everywhere we have this terrible competition. So I think this is a problem. We should overcome this competition. As you said, it's a narcissistic game, because it's destroying our ability to care and be for others. Yeah, that means the innermost human dignity is destroyed by this. So in Europe, we are under conditions of abundance. So we should reduce this pressure. I think the first one idea is to redistribute larger parts of the income of the society for what we are calling basic income, but giving it to people who want to care for others, to organize projects. That means not to compete. Those who make the decision, I do not want to compete with the others. I will try to experiment to be for others in a sensible way. Yeah? So different projects, cultural projects, ecological projects, social projects, and so on. To experiment with other ways of living, bringing together agriculture and the urban cities. So we will know this, my bread was made by this peasant, and so on. And in this way, it was used in this way. So all the goods we are using today, we do not know the history of these goods anymore. We do not know who has made it. They are totally without any face to us. They don't speak to us. Nature does not speak to us anymore. Yeah? So we should try by this way to create more and more possibilities to somehow to reinvent achievements, parts of traditional societies under the modern conditions, which are very much in favor of the internet, of sharing, of whatever. Yeah.
In the modern conditions.
Yeah.
And there you have the so-called globalization. The globalization that you talk about from the capitalist point of view is a T-shirt produced by cheap labor in Bangladesh and sold in the supermarkets.
Yeah. For 2 euro. And used only one or two times.
Yes.
And then, that's normally in Germany. A T-shirt is used one or two times because the person has to pay only 2 euros.
Right.
That means it's nothing. Right. It's nothing. So we are behaving to the work, to the labor, and also to the nature which is in the T-shirt as nothing.
Right.
And this is killing.
And the person who produced it probably doesn't have a chance to put on this T-shirt at all.
Yeah.
Okay. So, I mean, as you said, how do the people who are seeking alternative, okay, people like us who are talking about alternatives, how do you connect the Bangladeshi worker and the consumer in the United States, for example? How can this commodity that they are using, the T-shirt, how can that commodity speak to the user to say that this, what you are putting on, is actually the product of the Bangladeshi worker? It contains the sweat, the labor of the Bangladeshi worker.
Yeah, that's why this type of globalization, where everything is so-called for free, that means under the pressure to produce for the lowest cost, to sell for the lowest cost, should be ended. And there are already attempts, I know it from Germany, to establish direct contacts between cooperatives of producers, enterprises of producers in Bangladesh, and directly to relate them to sales organizations in Germany. And then we will again value what we are using. The richer people of this, the richer middle classes of this world don't value the majority of the products, that means the majority of the labor of the others anymore. This should be ended, so we should ask how we can maybe end it at the informal level, but later also on the formal level, ending this type of globalization. We should have other forms of cooperation, but not under the rules of so-called free competition.
Right. I totally agree with you. But we need some kind of organization, okay, to counterpose cooperative of producers and cooperative consumers. And then those are the ones which are linked. Now we know that in the past, you know, we have gone through the experiments of one-party systems, vanguard parties, okay, even social movements and so on. But these organizations, for example, if you go by what happened with the Arab Spring, the mass movement in a sense, but how this mass movement could not sustain themselves and are very easily co-opted and hijacked.
Yeah, because these movements were not able really to change the institutional structures and the institutional based dependency. You see, if under the rules of the World Trade Organization, there is no chance to organize, no large scale chance to exchange and trade and so on. Yeah? Right. We have the same with the agreements between the European Union and African countries. Right. Yeah? This is not the way. So at this stage, we are at the beginning of a new wave. I think there is a growing awareness that this is leading to a total breakdown of our civilization. And a lot of people really know this. Yeah? So that is the time we should experiment. We should see. And I think there are a lot of possibilities. Also, stronger cooperation between cities or regions in Germany and countries. We have now in the Middle East. We have concrete contacts to support each other. Yeah. Energy production, learning how you are doing it, how we are doing it, as on equals. Not this called development aid, where the white people are coming and telling the others how to do it. Right. No. We should learn from each other. We cooperate. And then we can say, okay, we can think there are seeds for a new type of cooperation. And then we should fight. We've been fighting in Europe for left governments, because without the help of governments, we can't change the international rules. We can't change the rules of cooperation. Yeah. So this is the next step we should go. And now we see in the United States, Bernie Sanders is competing for presidency. He has no chance at this moment, but nevertheless, for the first time, a proclaimed democratic socialist is almost an equal in one of the large parties, the two large parties in the United States, the same Labour Party, by really a democratic socialist. We have other tendencies, and so I'm quite sure we are looking forward for a decade or decades maybe of a strong polarization and a re-emergence of totally new forms of socialist struggles. Not with one part, solidarity-based cooperation, and how can we bring this cooperation and community building into a system growing, and here hoped, at least in the 1960s, I'm convinced, emerge from the bottom up. I think democratic socialist is almost an equal in one of the large parties, the United States, the same Labour Party, by really a democratic socialist. We have other tendencies, and so I'm quite sure we are looking forward for a decade or decades maybe of strong polarization and re-emergence of totally new forms of socialist struggles. Not with one part, much more solidarity-based cooperation, and how can we bring this cooperation and community building system growing, and here hoped, at least in the 1960s, I'm convinced that this can emerge from the bottom up. It seems very deep contradiction, so he tried it more from the top later.
I quite agree with you on that. But, you know, we have this very interesting contradictory process.
Yeah.
The process is moving really fast. Mm-hmm. On the one hand, we have this massive movement, okay, even from a social democratic point of view, and you find all over the world almost rightist governments. Even that short period of left governments coming to power in Latin America, now we have seen the backlash, okay, one after another, where they start with Venezuela, Ecuador, Brazil, Argentina, and so on. You know. On the other hand, as you are saying, there are these new elements we are witnessing. Bernie Sanders. Mm. Okay. Whatever one may think of Bernie Sanders, socialism. Mm. The only fact he used the word socialism in the United States.
No, but he's challenging, by using this word, he's challenging the whole capitalist establishment of the oligarchic establishment of the United States. This is important about this word. That means for the first time, a real challenge in the heart of the system. Yeah, this is new. This is new. And you see, we often in Europe, we are looking to Latin America or somewhere else and saying, okay, they couldn't do it. We are in a much better position. We, as the task for the European socialists, we should prove that it's possible.
Right, yeah? Right.
We have much more possibilities, much more power, much more industrial productive capacity. And the problem is, as I already said, we are misusing this capacity to make it much more difficult for the others. And then we are saying, okay, you couldn't do it.
Yeah, you're right. The movement, particularly in Europe, the movement has to be pressure on their own governments.
But you see, we have a right-wing, as you said, a strong right-wing force. On the other hand, we have there was a referendum in Switzerland, and at least 25 basic income. That means not to the ability to compete in this terrible red race. Yeah? For a European Union, 60% are more or less in favor for such a can live without this pressure. We should reduce this pressure. So this is really a new situation. Then you see we have together organized in...
Tell us something more about this basic income movement.
There's a basic income movement is the idea behind is that by living to be a rich society, money you are spending, the time you have to be with others, to spend for others, to care for others. So this is the idea behind. We have a concrete movement, free public transport. That means everybody in our cities should have the ability to use public transport. We have about, let's say, 15-20% of the population not able to pay because they are too poor. In Germany, older people who can't pay for the public transport. So it should be free. And we have the same movement, let's say, in Brazil. That means basic goods of the society should be free for all. And then we can reduce our dependency on car. We are spending 20-25% of our income, those who can pay for it, for a car. That's crazy. Why are we free to move everywhere?
And the question is, how do we link that effort with some of the movements, which are, again, for living basic life in the South? Because it seems to me that we have to expand our vision of the concept of the neighbor.
Yeah.
So the neighbor is not the next door neighbor, but the neighbor in another country is also
your
neighbor.
Yes, I agree, yes.
You know? You know, so this has to be linked up. I think we have to create some solidarity, that whole movement, which is at a global level.
Yes, that's why I think, let's take this example of free public transport.
Right.
You see in most of the cities of the South, there's no ability to scale public transport system and the private car system.
Right.
So what is chosen is more or less a public car-based system by the paid as available to the middle classes. That means a split in society. What I think is clearly solidarity. We in the North should fight for this free public transport and creating examples, because it's much cheaper, it's much more ecological, it's much more democratic. The cities will look totally different. That means for me the first task of solidarity is we should live in a way which is compatible and in solidarity with the South. This is our first task.
Yes,
we have now an imperial mode of life. With our mode of life of the cars, energy production, using, buying goods, wasting goods, and so on, we are exploiting nature, we are exploiting the South, this should be ended. This is our main task. And the second, included in it, we should build up very concrete movements, concrete movements, yeah, on a different type, let's say, of production, agricultural production, in the North and in the South, doing it together, because I think in the end, in the 21st century, we should converge.
Yes.
It's not that the South can go into the direction of the North.
Right.
No. We see it, but this is totally dangerous and it's destroying. But we should, the North should change in a way which can be universalized, and this helps the South to go in the same direction. This is, I think, what solidarity. And of course, we do not waste so much energy anymore, yes, because we are porting all the energy intensive products from China, from Africa, and somewhere else. Yeah.
So they're moving the
world. And then blaming the others, you should do more. No, no, this is totally crazy. We have our own debt to pay, and that's why we should also advance in this direction, because there are a lot of starting costs for solar energy, for other forms. So we should pay the starting cost, and then we have the debt, we have the obligation to give this technology for free to everybody.
Right.
For free.
Exactly.
Without any patents and so on.
No, yeah.
It should be for free.
Yeah. I think that's the kind of pressure
yeah.
which would express in concrete yeah. terms the solidarity
yeah.
that
yeah.
you're talking
this
about.
This is totally clear. The idea now is, okay, we do it in Germany, and then we sell this technology to the others.
Yeah.
No, we should develop it, and then we should give it free for everybody and help even to establish it.
Exactly. And the question is, since both of us are intellectuals,
yeah.
you know, we should begin where we are.
Yeah.
It seems to me that we have to create situations very consciously through links and integration of creating some kind of insurrection of ideas at the global level, this type
yeah.
of ideas. Not simply ideas which are the monopoly of the North.
Mm-hmm.
Okay? But
we can't develop our ideas from the North in isolation, because
right.
if I'm right, that we should live and produce in a way which is in solidarity with the South, we won't know how to do it without this dialogue. It's totally impossible.
Right. Yeah. Mm. So how do we, I think we have to, even if small measures, we have to bring our intellectuals of the North and the South together.
Yeah, we should bring intellectuals, we should bring, like in the World Social Forum, we should bring together the social movements.
Yes.
There's a lot of networking, very concretely.
Mm.
Often we are forgetting that under the surface there are a lot of very concrete movements. We are thinking about a kind of global university where we can
yeah.
learn together.
Yeah.
Yeah? We should exchange, we should work on even stories. That means inventing new ideas is a collective enterprise. Yeah? And we should concentrate on it, and we should all the time experiment in a very deep discussion and dialogue with grassroots movements, because intellectuals have to express, this is, I think, their task, the praxis and the hopes, expectations of.
You see, and I think this movement in the North for clean environment,
yeah.
for public transport, for clean energy, okay, is very important if it also brings into dimension
yeah.
that its pressures on their own government, on their own corporations, for example, for clean industries, can also mean, it has already begin to be, the dirty industries are moved to the
yeah,
South.
Yeah, that's Germany is saying we do not waste so much energy anymore, yes, because we are porting all the energy intensive products from China, from Africa, and
right.
somewhere else. Yeah.
Right. So they're moving the world.
And then blaming the others, you should do more. No, no, this is totally crazy. We have our own debt to pay, and that's why we should also advance in this direction, because there are a lot of starting costs for solar energy, for other forms. So we should pay the starting costs, and then we have the debt, we have the obligation to give this technology for free to everybody.
Right.
for free, exactly. Without any patents and so on. No, yeah. It should be for free.
Yeah, I think that's the kind of pressure which would express in concrete terms the solidarity that you're talking
this
about.
This is totally clear. The idea now is, okay, we do it in Germany and then we sell this technology to the others.
Yeah.
No, we should develop it and then we should give it free for everybody and help even to establish it.
Exactly. And the question is, since both of us are intellectuals,
you know,
we should begin where we are.
Yeah.
It seems to me that we have to create situations very consciously through links and integration of creating some kind of insurrection of ideas at the global level, this type of ideas. Not simply ideas which are the monopoly of the North.
Mm-hmm.
Okay? But
we can't develop our ideas from the North in isolation because if I'm right that we should live and produce in a way which is in solidarity with the South, we won't know how to do it without this dialogue. It's totally impossible.
Right. Yeah. Mm. So how do we, I think we have to, even if small measures, we have to bring our intellectuals of the North and the South together.
Yeah, we should bring intellectuals, we should bring, like in the World Social Forum, we should bring together the social movements. Yeah, there's a lot of networking, very concretely. Mm. Often we are forgetting that under the surface there are a lot of very concrete movements. We are thinking about a kind of global university where we can learn together.
Yeah.
Yeah? We should exchange, we should work on even stories, that means inventing new ideas is a collective enterprise, and we should concentrate on it, and we should all the time experiment in a very deep discussion and dialogue with grassroots movements, because intellectuals have to express, this is, I think, their task, the praxis and the hopes, expectations of the ordinary people.
Yes.
And this is, I learned by Nyerere, what he thought about education.
Education
should be useful for the majority.
Right. And education should be liberating.
Yeah.
You see, not enslaving.
Yeah. Now it's enslaving. To
yes, it's very much enslaving.
Yeah.
And that is where
we learn how to be good slaves. Hmm?
Exactly.
Or teaching.
Yeah, educated to be good slaves.
Yeah, at the labor market.
Yes. That's what I'm saying, that we, in our own ways, we have to try to create this very consciously, these links, you know, through various forms of movements. For example, there is this agriculture movement in Latin America, okay?
Mm. Landless movement and so on, food sovereignty movement. And this, I think, I'm working for the Rosa Luxemburg Foundation. Rosa Luxemburg was a person which was in deep solidarity, and for her, She has written a very famous piece on the Russian Revolution. And there's a sentence, freedom is the freedom of the dissenter or of the others. We can't be free when we are not working to create the conditions of the freedom of others.
Right.
This was her thinking, and the Rosa Luxemburg Foundation tries, we have 20 offices abroad, to use this network to facilitate such a cooperation.
Yeah, I think that's important. In fact,
that's why we are meeting also. Yeah?
this quotation, actually, in my first speech when we launched the Nyerere Resource Center, which is Swahili because Kavazile Mwalimu Nyerere, that's exactly what I quoted from Rosa Luxemburg. Okay, that you cannot simply fight for your freedom, but you have to fight for the freedom of others.
Yeah, then you can be free, and she died for it.
She sacrificed her life. Because so long as there is a slave anywhere in the world, we are not free.
Yeah, that's
funny. I mean, that's what Che Guevara said, you know. So long as there's injustice anywhere in the world, you cannot.
Yeah, and we should not forget, European capitalism started with slave trading.
Yes.
At the African coast, bringing them and so on. This was the starting point of so-called European enlightenment, European modernity and so on, the enslavement. The problem is, in the end, the slaveholders became somehow slaves themselves. That's the irony.
Yes,
we should, so that's the task now. We should get rid of this new type of modern slavery, enslaving ourselves by enslaving the others.
Exactly. Exactly. So when you're fighting for freedom and liberation, you're also liberating the slave owner.
Yes. And that's why even the slaveholder should fight against slavery. Yeah.
Yes, I think we had some interesting discussion. We should continue these ideas.
I hope so.
Because it seems to me that, I think you would agree with me, the choice before us is socialism or barbarism.
That's what Rosa Luxemburg said, and I think it's more, even more valid today than at this time, because now we see this deep crisis of capitalism, and we see a lot of wars. We had never since 1945 so much refugees, especially in Africa, in the Middle East and so on, but all over the world. So we see new elements of barbarism, and this can be very dangerous in a short time.
That's right, and we can see that how some of the right governments are actually preparing war. Mm. Many of them are warmongers. You know? So really, that is our choice. And that is, I think, we in a very offensive manner.
Yeah.
I think it behoves on us intellectuals to bring it out, rather than be shy about it.
Yes.
But that's the blatant choice.
That was my thesis, that we are on a starting point of a new third wave of socialism, aiming at a civilizational transformation in the 21st century. That's our task for the next decades.
For the next decade. I agree with you. Thank you very much, Professor.
This is
just the beginning of the conversation. And we hope to continue these conversations. And we hope that, again, we'll try to get Professor Bier to come here.